Good day, I'm Norman Wildberger. Today we're going to talk about factoring polynomials and polynumbers. First, I'll review some basic facts about factoring with ordinary natural numbers. So, a few definitions, just to remind you. If 2 times 3 equals 6, we say that 6 is a multiple of 2 or a multiple of 3. And we say that 2 and 3 are divisors or factors of 6. If we take a bigger number, like say 1001, then it can be factored in a number of different ways. It can be written 77 times 13, or 7 times 143, or as 1 times 1001, that's also a factorization. So although it may appear that there's lots of different ways of factoring a number, there's a very important and fundamental theorem, called in fact the fundamental theorem of arithmetic, which says that every natural number can in fact be factored uniquely, in other words, in only one way, up to order, into prime factors. A prime number, I remind you, is a number that only has 2 factors, namely 1 and itself. For example, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13, 17, 19, and so on. So the fundamental theorem of arithmetic means that we can express every natural number as a product of prime numbers. And there's only one way of doing that, up to the order in which we present those primes. So for example, 1001 is 7 times 11 times 13. 1002 is 2 times 3 times 167. 167 is prime. 1003 is 17 times 59. 1004 is 2 squared times 251. There's no reason why a prime factor can't appear more than once in the factorization of a number. There's 1005, those 1006. And this already indicates a major interesting aspect of this, that factoring large numbers is highly unpredictable. It's not at all obvious how to extend this table to the next 20 or 30. There's a few patterns that are kind of obvious. I mean, obviously every even number is divisible by 2. And if this number is divisible by 3, then the one 3 after it is also going to be divisible by 3. But aside from those relatively trivial remarks, it's very hard to predict how a random big number factors into primes. And that's a major important fact when it comes to encrypting information, say, on the internet. This unique factorization theorem plays a very important role. All right, so we're not going to prove these facts. These are kind of standard facts. There's nothing problematic about them, I think, once you've set up arithmetic as we've done. But we are going to be interested in extending this kind of thinking to polynumbers and polynomials, which are, as we've seen last time, just certain types of polynumbers. The polynumber 1, 2 times the polynumber 3, 5 is the polynumber 3, 11, 10. So we say that 3, 11, 10 is a multiple of 1, 2 or a multiple of 3, 5. And we say that 1, 2 and 3, 5 are factors or divisors of 3, 11, 10. And a natural question is, suppose we were given 3, 11, 10, how could we find its factors? Well, for that it helps to look at the general formula. If we multiply the binomial AB with the binomial CD, we get AC, AD plus BC, and BD. That's a trinomial. So if we stare at this, then this helps us solve this problem. For example, suppose you're given the trinomial 7, 45, 18. And you want to write it as AB times CD for some AB and some CD. Well, then A times C has got to be 7. And these are natural numbers. A and C are either 1 and 7 or 7 and 1. In other words, the set AC has got to equal the set 1, 7. Similarly, B times D has got to equal 18. So now there are more possibilities because 18 is not prime. They could be 1 and 18, or 2 and 9, or 3 and 6, in either order. And there's one more piece of information. The middle term AD plus BC, this times this plus this times this, has got to equal 45. And now it's a standard kind of little game that one plays, looking at all the possibilities. How can we choose these two numbers? And how can we choose a pair here so that the A times the D plus the B times the C should equal 45? Well, there's only going to be one way, and that turns out to be, so suppose we tried 1 times 9 plus 7 times 2. Well, that wouldn't work. But 1 times 3 plus 6 times 7, 1 times 3 plus 6 times 7, that would work, giving us 45. And so that's how we get the factorization, by essentially looking through all the possibilities encoded by these three equations. In more familiar high school terms, what we've done is we've taken the trinomial 7 plus 45x plus 18x squared, and we factored it into two binomial expressions, 1 plus 6x and 7 plus 3x. We rather think of this expression as representing this equality between this polynomial and these two polynomials. But it's really the same thing. So at this point, it's probably a good exercise for you to take a few binomials, polynumbers, and multiply them to get a trinomial, and then put it aside for a day or two, and then come back and see if you can factor those trinomials. Go reverse the process to find the factors. Some trinomials cannot be factored. If you just write down a random one, then it's very likely that you cannot be factored. For example, it's not hard to see that the polynumber 151 cannot be factored into two binomials. So the natural question is, should we call that kind of polynumber a prime polynumber? That certainly strikes us as reasonable. However, an interesting complication arises. When we move from binomials and trinomials to slightly larger polynumbers. And here's a very interesting example. The polynumber 1 minus 1, 1, which is itself a trinomial, times 1, 1, 1, is 1, 0, 1, 0, 1. So this polynumber, which is a positive polynumber, factors, but one of its factors, this one here, is a polynumber with a negative coefficient. Up to now, we have not been including this possibility. We've only restricted ourselves to positive coefficients. But it turns out that if we do that, then we miss out on this phenomena here. And this is something that's quite different between polynomials or polynumbers and ordinary natural numbers. For ordinary natural number division or factorizing, negative numbers play no essential role. However, for polynumbers, they play a very important role. Certain factorizations are possible with negative coefficients, which are simply not possible if you restrict to positive coefficients. So the mathematics is forcing us to enlarge our view. We're going to have to move from positive polynumbers to talking about integral polynumbers. And what is an integral polynumber? It's an expression just like a positive polynumber, except that the entries are allowed to be integers. This defines a new mathematical object called an integral polynumber, and we'll give it this title, polyint, for integral polynumber. And this is a very nice realm in doing arithmetic with polynumbers. It's in fact better in many ways than sticking to positive polynumbers. So we're going to have to do that now. We're going to have to rethink what we've done, move to integral polynumbers, and investigate the arithmetic of these. When we do that, we will see that primes and fundamental theorems come into focus for us, and it becomes very rich and beautiful. So next time, it's arithmetic with integral polynumbers. I hope you'll join me for that. I'm Norman Wildberger. Thanks for listening.